Hi, this is José Luis, and in this video, I would like to teach you how to write multi-dimensional arrays in C Sharp. And you may wonder, why do I even need multi-dimensional arrays? What does that even mean? So let's think about what we've learned in the previous videos. We know that arrays are really good structures for storing a list of ordered values. Values that can be numbers, booleans, strings, whatever, one after the other, to which we can refer by the position at which they are on the list. So this is really useful for storing large collections of data in one dimension, meaning we only have one list and the position is basically just in one dimension. This is great for lists of things, but very often you will find yourself in the necessity of storing not only list of things, but lists of things. So for example, imagine we were writing a system to keep track of the mail that is arriving to a particular large building. A large building that has several floors, and then each floor has several apartments per floor. So if that's the case, and I wanted to have a Boolean variable that tells me whether if a particular apartment has mail or not, then the only way that I have, if I only know how to write one-dimensional arrays, it could be something like declaring, well, let me create an array of booleans, and I'm going to call this has mail, and then the for floor, and this is going to be a new array of booleans of, and I'm going to use here apartments per floor, which is how many apartments are on my floor. But if I do this, I could only store a list of booleans for one particular floor. So for example, the first floor, which means that I would probably have to give this a number, has floor number 0 mail, and then I can store each one per. And then if I wanted to do every floor, I would have to end up doing something like this. I would have to end up handwriting manually one array of Boolean values for each one of the floors so that I could keep each one of the apartments on that floor in memory. You can probably imagine how this is terrible practice, because anything that means hard coding is a terrible thing. And also because this is not flexible. If for any reason the number of floors in my building would change, which is not a common situation, but I don't know, maybe they make an extension, or maybe I would just want to change, use this code for a different building that has more floors. This is just not sustainable. And also I can just not iterate with for loop over all these different variables. So the solution is, in this case, instead of using one dimensional arrays, we can use, which is what we know how to do from previous videos, we can use multi-dimensional arrays. Multi-dimensional arrays are arrays that have more than one dimension, aka they can store data across a list, and then inside of that list, they contain another list, if you will. The idea is that, for example, in this example, I'm going to teach you how to do 2D arrays, so arrays that have two dimensions, and they're multidimensional because one of the conditions for this particular code that I'm going to write here is that those two dimensions are constant in size. So for example, if we have 9 floors, the condition for the code that I'm going to be writing today is that each one of those floors has the same amount of apartments. So that if we were to imagine this in an abstract way, my two-dimensional array would have the same number of columns and the same number of rows in every dimension. It's like a square matrix of values, if you will. Okay? So how do we do that? It's actually pretty simple. The way we do that is we say, for example, let me store in an array, but I'm going, instead of just using the simple square brackets, I'm going to add a comma inside of the square bracket to denote that this type of array is not just one dimension, it's two dimensions. And then I'm going to call this variable has mail. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new array, a new two-dimensional array, but just like with any array, when I create this array, I have to specify what the dimensions of each one, how much room does this array have for data. So in the first dimension, I'm going to use how many floors my building has. So for example, I'm going to use the number floors here, all right? And then here, I'm going to say apartments per floor. So my building has 5 apartments per floor. So now my array, my two-dimensional array, has 7 spots in the first dimension, and then has 5 spots in the second dimension. Therefore, once we have that, what I can do is, and let me create another one. I'm going to create a string because I'm going to just keep the name in memory for each one of these, apartments. So I'm going to create another array called apartments, and it's going to be a new string array, two-dimensional, which is going to have floors in one dimension and apartments per floor. So the same size as my Boolean array. And then, because it's a two-dimensional array, the best way to navigate and to populate these two arrays is going to be with a set of 2 nested for loops, which we have also seen in previous videos in this playlist. So I'm going to create a for loop, which is going to be the first dimension. I is going to be the floors. So I is going to start at 0, is going to be less than the amount of floors we have, and then is going to increase by 1 unit. And then inside, I'm going to create another for loop that is going to iterate over the dimension of the apartments. So for int I j, which is going to be the second one, equals 0, j is less than apartments per floor, and j is going to increment in units of 1. So now I have 2 for loops that iterate over each one of the floors, and then in the floors, each one of the apartments. Okay, I like the architectural metaphor of this example actually a lot. It's very visual to see, right? And then with this now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to populate data into this arrays. So for apartments, I'm just going to create a string name for this apartment. So that's going to be, for example, apartment, and I'm going to use string literals, which we have also seen in previous videos. So the name of the apartment is going to be the number of the floor, a 0, and the number of the apartment. So that's going to be apartment, then the variable I, which is which floor am I in, and then maybe instead of a 0, I'm going to use a dash, for example. And then here I'm going to do the j, which is the number of the apartment that I am in. And I'm going to put a semicolon to stop here. I have an error. This is telling me that I cannot convert from string to a string multidimensional array, and that is because I made an error, which is that I'm trying to assign a string to the whole array. But I need to, as you know already, I need to point to which position in my array I want to save this string to. So I forgot this, so I'm just going to open and close curly brackets, square brackets, and then it's going to be I for the first dimension, the floor that I'm in, and j for the second dimension, the apartment that I am in. And now for hasMail, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to open and close square brackets, I floors for the first dimension, j apartments for the second dimension, and I'm going to initialize them to false. Okay? Absolutely fine. So all the apartments are going to start with a false, with no mail. Then let me see if this code runs. This code runs, it does absolutely nothing. Right now, it only creates those 2 arrays in memory. Now I can finish that. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to imagine that my code, once this is the initialization of my code, then I have some other thing connected to the mail delivery, whatever, which changes the value of the truth and false in my array. So for example, some algorithm that tracks mail and updates as mail. Okay, so this is a placeholder for some algorithm that figures out how to change that. And then the way that would work is that basically that algorithm would say, would go to the array and say, for example, in floor number 2, apartment number 3, there is male. So I'm going to change that to true. And then in some other apartment, for example, in apartment 6 and number 0, then that one is also going to have some male. So you can see that floor number 6, remember we start counting by 0, floor number 2, and then here apartment number 3 and apartment number 0. Those two are going to have male. And then I'm just going to check male in all apartments. So I'm just going to print to the console a full list of all the apartments and whether if they have male or not. How am I going to do that? I'm going to do also with a for loop, with a nested for loop, where I'm going to go over all the apartments. And I'm just going to print to the console a message saying whether if apartment blah 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 has or not male. So for example, I'm going to write here the name of the apartment. So apartments I, comma J, and then I'm going to write has male. And then here I'm going to write the value of the Boolean array that I just created. I'm going to run this code and then let's see what happens. So it looks like, it looks like if I extend this window and I zoom in, you can see that basically none of the apartment has male except for apartment in position 2-3, which has male, and apartment in floor number 6, apartment 0, which is true. This is a very computational building. Floors and apartments start with number 0, which is great. Okay. So that's pretty much it. So remember that in this example, we have used 2 dimensions for the arrays. So that's why we started this with a square bracket and only one single comma inside, which means 2 dimensions. But if, depending on the use that we have, we may actually need more than 2 dimensions. Imagine we are, for example, designing a very complex building that has floors, it has sections within the floor, and then it has apartment with each is one of these sections. So maybe we need 3-dimensional arrays in that case. Or maybe we're trying to represent a 3-dimensional space of voxels, and then those voxels can be represented with a 3-dimensional array. Who knows? Okay. The only condition is that if we write arrays this way, in a multi-dimensional way, is that the dimensions in each one of the directions have to have the same amount of elements. That's just it, okay? So multi-dimensional arrays work in 2D, 3D, 4D, 5D, whatever you need. It's up to you, all right? Wonderful. Thank you very much. If you like this video, please hit the like button, maybe subscribe to the channel and show some gratitude to the work that we do. And then hopefully see you in some other video on this playlist. Thank you.